We're moving on to season 3, but before we do, we got to look at the trades. There were only 3 trades, including my own, Holiday for Carey. Rams traded for Charlie Gardner from the Buccaneers for Adam Timmerman, which I don't understand. They already have Marshall Faulk and Steven Jackson at running back. I understand that Faulk is long in the tooth, but he's still producing as their lead back, while Steven Jackson is just sitting behind waiting to start. Charlie Gardner barely got any touches. I just don't understand this trade. Buccaneers, on the other hand, got a starter out of Adam Timmerman, instantly boosts that offensive line. He's good at both pass and run blocking, not very aggressive, but he's strong enough to hold his own. The other trade involved the Bengals trading away Burt Barry for the Panthers running back Steven Davis. This one made more sense. They have Chris Perry, but with Steven Davis' style of running, I think they pair well with each other. Davis is primarily a power back. He won't try to dodge a tackler, but he sure as heck will make a tackler dodge him. Chris Perry, on the other hand, is elusive. He did better than Davis this season, and I wouldn't be surprised if he has most of the carries on the team next year. The Panthers got a starter in Burt Barry from the trade. He only played in 10 games. His sack total was half of what he had with the Bengals the previous year. This could be a player on decline. Unlike last year, this season we had a Pro Bowler. Jason Taylor made it, but Sam Madison didn't. Just like the real Pro Bowl, these things mean nothing. Our first year we were 13th in the power ranking. Second year we finished 17th, which to be honest was expected based on how bad the defense regressed. The owner wasn't happy about it and he gave us an earful. Pretty sure I turned off the ability for the owner to fire me, but I don't remember. So either way, he just wants us to win the division. If you saw the last video, you know we finished 8-8 and we're a pretty decent home team. We haven't reached any of our goals. Now you can see why the owner was mad. We did get an email which explained that during retirement, some of these guys aren't really ready to retire. They just need a little more incentive. Those rich bastards. We had 2 players considering retirement, Sam Madison and Junior Seau. Sam Madison, of course, had an 8 interception season, still didn't make the Pro Bowl somehow. If he were to retire, it would open up $7.83 million in the cap, but look at the depth behind him, it's not very good. So I considered giving him what he wanted, but he really didn't want to come back. Do you think Sam Madison is worth $54 million for 1 year? Maybe. Junior Seau had a 17-year career. This past season, he came back down to his regular production, considering that he regressed hard. Who's to say he won't regress even further? Even though we don't have amazing depth behind him, his retirement would free up another $4.06 million. I did see what he wanted, which was on average a $7 million a year deal. It isn't too bad, but we could use the cap space. We said goodbye to Madison Seau, thank you for being a Dolphin. Of course, they weren't the only ones to retire. Joe Jurevicius hangs it up after last year's both McCardell and Galloway retired. If you haven't checked my Cleveland Browns franchise, Madden 09, he caught a touchdown in the Super Bowl. Fun fact, Shelton Quarles was signed by the Miami Dolphins in 1994 as an undrafted player. Jeff Posey is calling it a career, along with Sam Gash and Jesse Armstead. The Bills got a little bit weaker. Eddie George is retiring after putting up really good back-to-back seasons. In reality, he officially retired in 2006, but last played for the Cowboys. Keith Traylor, I remember this guy. He played on the Miami Dolphins for a few seasons before the worst coach in history kicked him off the team. Aaron Glenn will be joining Traylor in retirement. He's currently the defensive coordinator of the Detroit Lions. Trent Dilfer is retiring 2 years earlier here than in real life. He won a Super Bowl, you know. Isaac Bruce will be finishing his career in St. Louis after a 13-year career. He never went to the 49ers. Nope. That never happened. Williams will be joining his teammate. I guess he thinks he can't keep up with the young ones. 16 years is impressive. 2 Hall of Famers retiring. The Rams team was stacked. I honestly had no idea Rod Woodson was in this game. 20 years at free safety and in the Hall of Fame. I guess Woodson retired so that Jerry Rice can continue to play.
I will never retire!
He's going into his 23rd season. The Patriots lost some big players to retirement. Troy Brown had an electric year, over 1,000 yards. Teddy Bruschi is also retiring. He had a strong season, and hopefully that means the division gets a little bit easier for us this coming season. Brock Marion is one of my favorite Miami Dolphins safeties. He is calling it a career in Detroit. Curtis Martin, Hall of Famer, tremendous career. Rating dropped off so much, it gets me worried about Ricky Williams. Honorable mention to Todd Collins. I'll never forget the season he helped Washington get to the playoffs the year Sean Taylor was killed. Let's move along to the re-signing period. We don't have a lot of players with expired contracts, but the ones that we do were mostly starters. The big name, John Kitna, is our number one priority to re-sign. He improved in his second season with the team, plus he's obviously better than Feely or Fielder. He's a 10-year pro. I don't know how much longer he'll want to play, considering he only wanted a 1-year deal. I convinced him to a 3-year deal. We can cut him without much cap penalty after 2 years. I don't know where we would be as a team without Kitna. Fielder will be gone soon, and I think if we have to, Feely can be relied upon as a backup. The other big name, Randy McMichael. He had a great season with the team, and that's because he still missed 4 games. Donald Lee, the backup, did very well as his replacement. Was that enough to convince me to let him go? No. McMichael is still cheap and worth a contract. Like, next year, Donald Lee will need a new contract, but we'll worry about that when we get there. Larry Chester is the next man up, but we did draft Sparks last season to replace him. He still had a pretty good season, especially for a contract year. I expect someone to overpay for him in free agency. Bradley Sparks was drafted for this exact scenario to replace him. To be fair, Larry Chester wasn't asking for a lot of money, but I just wanted to move on to our younger guys who can still improve. We traded for Vonnie Holiday because Jay Williams was not performing well at all. That means we're not re-signing him. He wanted a 2-year deal, but for an aging veteran, I don't think that's worth it on our end. I actually considered restructuring Holiday's contract, but I chose to hold off on that for now. The last name on the list, Arturo Freeman. He's a decent tackler and a good overall player. I just feel like we've seen his ceiling. Bua had a better season than Freeman as a playmaker, and that's what I want out of my free safeties. Playmaking ability. I did see what Freeman wanted, and it was obvious that I was not going to bring him back. Say your final goodbyes to Chester, Freeman, and Williams. Now we move on to the best part of the NFL. Free agency. This year, it's headlined by Ferguson, Weaver, Wilson, and Johnstone. Vernon Carey was not re-signed by the Cowboys, so technically he could return home, but I already have his replacement. I did consider signing Aaron Beasley, but to be honest, most of the free agents aren't starter quality. They're backups or depth signings, nothing to really boost the team. So I skipped it, again. I didn't go over the combine too much last video. The way it works is you can put hours into players that you want to scout. 1 hour for a basic report, 2 hours for a more in-depth report, and 3 for a full report. You get 9 hours a day and you only get 4 days to scout. So really, you can only fully scout 12 players. 1 hour gets you coaches' notes, 2 gets you a vague idea of what their key attributes are, such as if a player is good or average. 3 fully reveals the attributes of the player, but not the player rating itself. I still skipped the combine though. This will be our second draft, and I would select Edmund King in the first round. We need a replacement at free safety. He's already just as good as Arturo Freeman. He's an instant starter. Our second round pick would be Luther Hammond. We need a replacement for Sam Madison's retirement. Hammond does this perfectly. Another instant starter. Our third round pick would be Bob Parsons. Juniors say I'll retire this offseason, and we need a replacement. Bob Parsons does exactly that. Our third instant starter. We are on a roll. We're in the fourth round now. Clinton Wells was selected. Late round defensive ends are definitely not the way to go. Thankfully, he's just here to replace Jay Williams in that backup role this season. Our fifth round pick is a defensive tackle, Roger Brooks. He's better than what I expected, plus he'll be serving as a depth player. Development is something I rely on heavily. Now, at this point, I went for best player available, Roosevelt Aguilar. He's a fullback. We already have two on the team, but with only two running backs, it doesn't hurt to have another one. In our final pick, Henry Jimenez. I'm a sucker for tall receivers. He'll be decent depth, and like I say, hopefully he develops. You remember last season, we went undefeated in the preseason, and well, we did it again. Start getting your tickets for the Super Bowl, boys. We didn't even get any injuries this time, so we're all healthy. We got a new guy in our top players this season, Marty Booker. I've said it once and I'll say it again, this was by far our best trade ever. David Boston is still on the top of the list somehow. He's also the last in the top players list. Now let's go through the roster. John Kitna somehow regressed even after doing better than last season. He's still the starter. We need to look for his replacement soon. The decline of Ricky Williams is happening. He's on the final year of his contract. Should I move on from him? Aguilar will be starting over Conrad, who's on his final year of his contract. Our strongest group, the wide receivers, Booker has completely blew me away. Chambers regressed slightly. I don't know how. And Boston stays consistently inconsistent. I'm really impressed with the development of Tolver. I've never actually seen a player regress and then improve the following season. Both McMichael and Lee did just that. I really have no clue how progression works in this game. Jake Grove has improved immensely since we acquired him. It'll be hard to let him walk next season. Sandoval has developed nicely and has firmly grasped the starting job at guard. James, with the most team-friendly contract in history, is still pretty decent. You know, when I traded for Orlando Brown, I did not think he would still be here in the third year. I am upset that Herrera still hasn't developed. Smith will have all that leverage going into the offseason, that's for sure. Bradley Sparks will be starting the season. Hopefully he gives this team a spark.
Oh, you stink!
He'll be paired with Tim Bowens. Jason Taylor is regressing. He's getting old. He's still better than a lot of players in the league. Unfortunately, we haven't hit on our draft picks for this position. We nailed Parsons. He'll be starting along with Greenwood, who is also on a contract year. Pope is on the bottom of the roster, but I think he's on the top of everyone's heart. He ain't going to start because, you know, Zach Thomas is just way too good, but we rooting for you, Pope. I think this team moved laterally on the cornerback position, but definitely on an upward trend. Hammond looks great. Allison and Samuel both got slightly better. I think this team is built for the future, 2 years or so from now. Irvin Lindsay was a nice surprise from the draft last season. He's still young and could only get better, right? Edmund King was our first round pick this season. He's looking good. I think this defensive back group is going to be the strength of our team for years to come. Of course, Odlindo Mare is still kicking. He had a long contract before I got here. And does he deserve it? I'm not sure. We've lost a lot of close games. Lastly, Matt Turk, he's on the final year of his contract with the team. Will I resign him? I really don't know. On a side note, David Boston will be taking over on the right side. Also, will Wanstead hit 100 wins first or 100 losses? Let's find out. As always, I simulate the first 5 games of the year. If I feel like we have to make a trade, I'll do it. Immediately, we got our butts kicked by the Colts, but we did bounce back and win games against the Browns and Steelers. Unfortunately, division games are still our downfall, losing to both the Bills and Patriots by less than a touchdown each. There were injuries on the team. Bowens is questionable, but I think he won't miss any games. Boston out with a broken foot, and the rookie Aguilar is out for a few weeks. John Kitna's rating may have dropped, but his stats are looking real good so far. 9 interceptions isn't great, but other than that, he's been really good. I think the offensive line is coming in real strong now. Ricky Williams has had the best start to the season since I've started. Everyone is getting their fair share of touches in the passing game. With Boston having a strong start, it makes sense that he got injured since this game hates Boston. McMichael is really becoming a weapon on this team, which is very nice to see. Look who's 3 tackles behind the tackling machine, Zach Thomas. Bob Parson. Remember when I was disappointed when Jason Taylor had 3 sacks that 1 year? He has 2. The bright spot is there's a lot of sacks from a lot of different players. I'm really loving the young guys we drafted. Lindsey has 3 interceptions. Not a lot of turnovers by this team as a whole, but the young guys are impressing. Odlinda Mare has missed 2 field goals. It better not have been against the Bills. Matt Turk also seems to be getting a lower average each season. It may be time to move on from him. I just wanted to quickly point out the trades. The Bengals were trading back and forth with the 49ers. Adam Timmerman is being tossed around like a salad, but Cardinals traded Anquan Boldin to Washington for Clinton Portis. That blew my mind. Now, I did consider making a trade myself. I looked to move Rob Conrad. Now, keep in mind, fullbacks are useful in this game, and I wanted to trade him for Keyshawn Johnson. Or even this rookie cornerback, but I felt like it would abuse the AI logic, so in the end, I ended up not even going through with the trade and continue with the roster I have. I didn't acknowledge this earlier, but Wanstead did hit 100 wins first. There was a point where Miami went on a 2-7 run this season, most of the losses being by a touchdown or less. They did get their revenge against the Chargers, though.
Go Chargers, go!
They also blew away the Patriots and got another win against the Bengals. The Dolphins were close to getting back to 500 at the end of the year, but those darn Ravens stopped that from happening. We've gone 9-7 to 8-8 to 7-9. I do think we're on that hump, but we need to get that playmaker to get us over it. This was the first year we weren't even in the conversation to get into the playoffs. I wonder if injuries had anything to do with our team not meeting expectations. Every year with this team, John Kitna has gotten better and better. Yeah, he threw 17 interceptions, but his completion percentage and touchdowns overrule that. He's done very well since we traded for him. Ricky Williams has really
grind that bones into dirt!
I'm actually very surprised he's still putting up these kind of numbers. We don't have many years left with Ricky being good. We need to capitalize it on the next 2 years. We shouldn't get our hopes up with Michael Turner suddenly being a beast, but you never know. He's consistent. We finally got not one, but 2,000 yard receivers. Surprisingly, Boston had a slow second half because, you know, the game hates Boston. The biggest shocker, Tolver playing very well on his contract year. Booker has gotten better every season with the team. I doubt next year he'll perform even better, but this team is stacked offensively. I wonder if anyone who thought giving Chambers that contract was a bad idea, he's done nothing but reward us with it. Having his best season in his career this year, McMichael put up similar numbers to last season. He's finally playing up to his potential, and hopefully he just gets better from here on out. Injuries kept him from playing a full season. Even if he did play all 16 games, I'm pretty sure he played injured. David Boston had a very mediocre season, but I'll give him the benefit of the doubt. The surprise of the season, J.R. Tolver. He, of course, would play infinitely better on a contract year. Seems like everyone gets better when they're about to get paid. I'm not sure if I'll bring him back, especially when we have Jimenez, who performed very well in only 3 games. I do want to point out Keyshawn Johnson. Had we traded for him, he could have came in very useful when Boston was out. Our linebackers were tackling machines this season. Zach Thomas was a beast this year. It's criminal that his rating went down considering he put up such great numbers. I'm glad he can teach Bob Parsons how to play like an elite Hall of Famer. He's already putting up amazing numbers for a rookie. Greenwood is a consistent player. A team doesn't need to be filled with amazing players. They just need a few amazing and a lot of good ones. Greenwood is a good one. Jason Taylor and Vonnie Holiday led the team in sacks, but this team spread the wealth all over. First season in a long time that Jason Taylor wasn't able to get a double-digit sack number. He could be on the decline, or it could just be a slump. After getting 5 sacks in 5 games last year, Holiday only got 6.5 in a full season. I'm not sure what happened to him, but he definitely didn't play like he did last season. Bradley Sparks finally got his first real game time this season, and he performed pretty well. He definitely played as well as Chester would have this season. Lateral move, but this is Chester's ceiling. this could be Sparks' floor. The rookie Edmund King had a decent rookie season, not going to blow you away, but not terrible. His draft class buddy Luther Hammond had a really good season, 4 interceptions and a pair of sacks. Not many interceptions this season, but both Lindsey and Hammond led the team. Our draft picks are coming in big. Lindsey was selected last season, he developed nicely. I think this backfield is going to be really good, and I'm hoping I'm right. Tony Bua doing his best in situational role. Asante Samuel got an interception this year after not playing all of last year. I don't know how Pope even gets on the field, but the one time he did, he goes and he gets an impact play. Bowen had a slump, but that's expected out of a 13-year veteran. He can't keep up his production from prior seasons. Adlinda Mare has been very consistent, but for his rating, I would have thought he'd be better. Matt Turk has been slumping each season since we started. We're probably not going to bring him back next season. Now let's move on to the season awards. The MVP goes to Matt Hasselbeck. Yes, that Hasselbeck. He had really good back-to-back seasons. This year it earned him the MVP. The Offensive Player of the Year, Dexter Rivera. You remember I joked about this guy being the next Peyton Manning? Well, he might actually be the next Peyton Manning. Defensive Player of the Year, Tony Parrish. Again, I'm actually surprised he didn't win it 3 times. What's scary is I think this guy's getting better. Defensive Rookie of the Year, Bob Parsons. Finally, one of my picks makes his name known. The numbers aren't flashy, but that's like
your opinion, man.
The rushing title goes to Ricky Williams. This season should have been the one where we go to the playoffs. I don't know if injury screwed us over, but I felt like this was a wasted chance. Now, of course, I gotta see how Carson Palmer did. I think he did better than his previous season, taking care of the ball more, but his quarterback rating says otherwise. I think Kitna outplayed him again. Patrick Surtain had himself a down year, but even in his down year, still pretty respectable. The Bears moved on from Adewale Ogunlaye, and he's now with the Eagles. After the first year of the trade, he's been very I wanted to check out the Bratsky, and the Bratsky had a super lackluster season. We finished 4th in the division, but this season, a lot of teams suddenly woke up, plus we're probably in the most competitive division. Do you think the 8-8 Washington... No, they lost. Never mind. Surprisingly, Chicago made and won a playoff game without Ogunlaye. Indianapolis blew Kansas City away. Pittsburgh beat Baltimore for the 2nd year in a row in the wild card. Only one home team advanced from the wild card. This year, every team that earned a bye week won their game. New England with the shutout, Tennessee with a division win, Atlanta coming back after losing the Super Bowl last year, and Seattle surviving Chicago. The Titans upset the Patriots, and Atlanta will be returning to the Super Bowl for the 2nd straight season. And unlike last season, they showed up offensively and took down the Titans. The Atlanta Falcons are your Super Bowl champions. Thank you for watching the video. If you enjoyed, press a thumbs up. If you did, subscribe to make sure you never miss out when I upload a new video. And we're heading into season 4 now. We have not had a 10-win season or a playoff appearance. This rebuild has been a disaster. Just like in real life.